I'm so, so excited to have the incredible neuroscientist James Coan with me today, all the way from the US, where it's freezing cold early in the morning, snowing. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you.
James is in Virginia, and he's the director of the Virginia Affective Neuroscience Laboratory at the university there. What an incredible job.
Thank you. I agree. I'm triply blessed to be able to do what I do.
And you were actually saying to me just offline about your background that's behind you, that it is somehow integrated with the course that you're teaching. The course is called Why We Hold Hands, correct?
Yes, that's right.
Can you tell me a bit about it? Tell us a bit about it?
Yeah, sure. So for years, I've been using handholding as a way of investigating how social support changes the way that the brain responds to threat. One of the things that we've been finding for 15 years now in multiple studies is that when you're holding someone's hand and we put you under threat of mild electric shock, which is, it's not that bad, but it's bad enough to make you a little frightened, that your brain perceives the threat cue as less threatening. And that has a cascade of effects throughout your brain and throughout your body that leaves you sort of healthier and happier. Initially, I chose handholding just because it was an easy way for me to look at social support in the context of the brain scanner.
Mm-hmm.
But shortly after we started doing the research, I got an email from a neurosurgeon in the UK who specializes in working on hands and hand injuries. And he said, you know, I hope Dr. Coan, that you don't think that the hand is incidental here. The hand is very special. And so I started learning over the years more and more about hands. Our hands are kitten bite. our hands are packed densely with sensory neurons that allow us to make all kinds of fine distinctions. And of course, we can clasp things with them. We can do, our hands are very special for all kinds of reasons. And I started as a sort of a side project initially, just going into the literature on hands and hand holding in particular. Mm-hmm. And what I discovered is that hand-holding, the behavior of holding hands with another person, is what we call a human universal, which is to say that it happens in every culture on earth, just like singing and dancing or, you know,
certain facial expressions are uniform across all cultures as well, not all of them. So something along those lines.
Yeah. So I started... And along the way, I discovered this cave art behind me. I didn't discover it. I wasn't the one going rooting around in the ground. But I found that others had discovered it. I found I started reading about them, and I learned that the oldest human art consists of these hand stencils. Mm-hmm. Where they would put their hand up against the wall and blow paint onto them and leave a picture of their hand. And so...
relevant and significant. What I love about that study of yours about the electric shock and handholding was there is a difference in the orbits of connection. So what you found was that the more intimate the connection, like the significant partner, there was a greater resistance to pain. Is that, yes. Am I right?
Well, that's more recent. Yeah. There was a greater resistance to anxiety.
Wow.
And there was the suggestion based on brain activity and how brain activity changed that there was a decrease in pain, but we didn't measure that specifically. We did just last year in collaboration with Marina's, Lopez Sola and Tor Wager, we did use a pain stimulus, and we found that in fact the handholding acts as an analgesic.
So how do you come into creating these studies? Is it just something that drives you and you go, I'm interested, can the lab test this? Or is it a collaborative thing?
Can you say that one more time?
Yeah. So how do you come up with the ideas for the studies to test? Like, oh, just things that you're interested in?
Right. Well, that gets us into some deep time for me. So a long time ago, I was the lab coordinator for a researcher and now therapist named John Gottman, who studies marriage and couples. And I worked with him for a long time and became very interested in how couples soothe each other, how couples navigate fighting. And of course, couples will fight. Couples do. There's no way to avoid it. But it turns out how couples fight has a lot to say about the future of the couple and whether they'll be happy or whether they'll be divorced and so forth. But in the context of studying how couples fight, I became really interested in this phenomenon that you see in couples that do well later on, which is that they're good at soothing each other physiologically in the context of conflict. And that soothing turns out to be vitally important for their ability to withstand all the weather that comes with a long-term relationship.
I feel you've just backed up what I said to my partner on the weekend. Thank you for this.
Well, I'm always happy to do that.
That does bring me to a really important question. With the increase in obviously physical distancing that we're experiencing as a result of the pandemic and with the deadline as to when back to normal will begin, we could be looking at a world with, you know, a lot less touch. What are the repercussions from the neuroscientists, you know, opinions on what that will do to us?
The first thing that not having touch is going to do to you is make you more anxious, because one of the purposes of touch is to tell your brain that it has less work to do when it comes to being vigilant for potential threats. When someone touches you, your brain reflexively and automatically, well, it depends on who it is. Like if it's, you know, right. It's not just any touch, but if it's your partner, who's touching you and you have a trusting, high quality relationship, then what's happening in your brain is going, okay, it's not just my two eyes here that are watching the world. It's also my partner's. And it's not just that my partner is another warm body that might get eaten by the monster instead of me. It's that my partner is invested in my well-being. And so that's the purpose. That's why we develop these relationships and we go through all these rituals, these insane rituals to prove to each other that we're committed, right? Those rituals have a real function. They over time train our brain to know that it can relax its vigilance because someone else is watching over me, just like the song.
So I absolutely love that. And you mentioned in one of the interviews I listened to, and I was like, you mentioned that we feel taller when we're with another person. And I'm also very short. I'm 152 centimeters. So the thought of any way to feel taller feels great. But on a very personal level, I was single for a whole 8 years. And Jim, what the kind of modern woman finds is that we can create a lot of things for ourselves and we're very self-sufficient. But that feeling of not being tall, there were moments when I was dealing with, you know, my mother's illness and things like that, where I felt viscerally unsupported and I felt small. I felt like I was overwhelmed and it was huge. And now that I have this partner, that difference, I do feel taller when I walk into a room with him or I get a phone call about my mother's condition. And I would love to know, I would love for you to tell our audience like what that actually is, why we feel taller, stronger, more confident with other people with us.
Well, this was one of the real puzzles. A colleague of mine did a study where they were looking at the slant of a hill. They had people standing in front of a hill, and they found that this is Denny Prophet and and some other colleagues, they found that when people look at a hill, it looks steeper than it actually is. This is normative. And that's just your brain saying, all else being equal, it would rather you didn't walk up the hill than walk up the hill.
And our brain's telling us that to protect us, right? To go, do you have enough
resources? Our resources
for ability?
Protect our resources, right. There has to be something really amazing up at the top of the hill to walk up the hill, right? But if you have someone standing next to you, if your friend is standing right next to you, the hill looks less steep. You actually see it as less steep. And so we set about trying to figure out why might that be the case? And it turns out that the way the brain creates a sense of self, this gets almost spooky. This gets almost like when I first discovered what I'm about to tell you, I went to consult with a colleague in religious studies who studies Buddhist notions of the self to just get a grip on what we were finding. It turns out the self is not a thing. You can't extract the self organ from your brain and weigh it or bounce it like a basketball. It's a process. It's a task, right? This is a very Buddhist conception of self right away, that it's a verb, not a noun, mm-hmm. right? It's something that you engage in. So you can say, okay, well, let's model how the brain creates that sense of self when you're alone or when you're with somebody, when you're getting your hand held. And it turns out that if you're getting your hand held by a total stranger, you respond to stimuli very differently when the stimuli is directed at the stranger versus when it's directed at yourself, mm-hmm. what your brain construes as yourself. But if it's your close friend or your partner, when we present stimuli to them, your brain looks almost exactly the same as when we present stimuli to you.
Wow.
It's like there's what we call a breach of individual separateness. And this is really important, getting back to the hill slope, because the reason that the hill looks so steep is that your brain feels like, I don't necessarily have the resources to do this.
Yeah.
You have the friend stand next to you, the hill gets less steep because you feel like you have more resources. Well, this was a puzzle. How does the brain, I mean, you're not presumably planning to eat your mm-hmm. friend when you get to the top and can literally consume their resources. How do you get their resources? It turns out that you get them by expanding yourself to include them. Incredible. So they become you and you become them. And therefore your efficacy, your ability to do work in the world expands mm-hmm. beyond your skin to include their resources as well. So on the one hand, you feel taller, but another way to put it is that the world feels smaller. The world feels less demanding.
This is that is exactly what I spoke to you about in terms of my experience, right? And I just want to, for everyone watching this, when you hear Brené Brown or me, not that I'm any comparing myself to Brené, but speakers like me say on stage, we are wired for connection. Our brains are wired for connection. It's because of people like Jim's work that we have those studies. Like what you just mentioned is literally one great example of the fact that our brains are literally wired. Our perception is changing based on individual or us. I mean, it's just mind-blowing. Yeah. And when you mention the body's energetic budget in a previous interview I heard, that's what you're referring to, aren't you? Our perception of...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, our bioenergetic budget is, you know, how much does our brain, so the world that we perceive is scaled to our bodies, right? It's scaled mm-hmm. to our bodies. So if something is relatively close to us, we intuit the distance in terms of our arm length, right?
Yeah.
So how many arm lengths away is that, you know, can of soup or whatever? And when something is very distant.
This is how I know there's really a snowstorm, that your first example was a can of soup.
Right, right.
What's in the pantry, love? What's in the pantry? Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. As you're saying, so your body's perceiving the can. How far away is the can of soup?
When something is very far away, or you're looking at something as big as a mountain that you might walk up. It, you know, your limbs, you know, and the size of your height are relatively limited in terms of using as a scale, mm-hmm. like inches or feet or centimeters, to understand height or distance. So what your brain defaults to is how much energy it perceives it has available to spend. Mm-hmm. To spend, that's its yep. budget, because there's a rule that we have to, it's the principle of least effort. We have to take in more energy than we expend, or else we die. That's not funny. I don't know why yeah. that makes me laugh.
It's just how it works. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just how it works. You have to do that. So your brain is very, very fussy about making sure that you have a surplus. So mm-hmm. it doesn't want you to do anything that it doesn't think that you're capable of doing. And if you perceive a demand that you don't have the resources for, that is stress. That is stress and anxiety and fear, right? And yeah. so when you expand yourself to include a partner, to include your group, to include your culture, your ability to interact with the world expands in proportion to that. And the world seems less fraught, because now going up that hill is a challenge. It's like fun, woo, and not a threat. It's a threat if the needle tips below what your brain perceives you have resources for.
And then you're James Franco in 127 hours. That's...
Yeah, yep. yeah.
Yep. So,
that's... Whew.
Yeah. Exactly. So that is incredible. Just to hear fear, anxiety, to hear stress defined like that so clearly from a neuroscientist is going to be so valuable to so many people watching. And that brings me to the next thing that I think everyone popularly knows, that there is a link between loneliness, a lack of human connection, and therefore a level of anxiety or even depression. But nobody actually talks, well, some people do, but with real clarity about how that's happening in the brain. Would you yeah. be able to explain that? I think it's going to change people's lives.
Well, I tell you that what happens when you're lonely is that you become like starved. It's like being malnourished. Mm-hmm. You are constantly running in a kind of deficit with that bioenergetic resource that we talked about a moment ago. Mm-hmm. And so your brain starts looking for ways to not spend any energy. So you sleep all day.
Wow.
You avoid anything that seems like it might cause you another stress response. And that avoidance becomes a cycle, and you become isolated, and the littlest thing can set you off, because your brain is going, do not spend, do not spend, do not spend any of your resources. Now, loneliness is even more of a trap, because remember back at the beginning of our conversation, we talked about those crazy rituals that we go through mm-hmm. to make sure that we can trust someone. Mm-hmm. Well, when you're lonely, There's something that my lab calls the Iago effect after Othello by Shakespeare, which is that the most dangerous thing for a human is not actually to be alone. It's to believe you're not alone. In other words, to trust someone when that person is not actually interested in your well-being, because then you become maximally exposed. Right? Wow. Because you let down your guard and nobody's actually watching for you. Hence the Iago effect. He's an untrustworthy villain. Yeah. So when we're lonely, the stakes become higher. And what we do is we paradoxically, even though we need people desperately, we hold people to higher standards. We require more evidence that they're really going to be there for us. And that keeps us trapped in a cycle of loneliness mm-hmm. because we hold people very often to a higher standard than is reasonable. and we go, that person is such a jerk, because we're really sensitive to little things that we all do that are silly or insensitive.
Yeah, I read a study that says something like the lonely brain perceives threats 3 times more than a non-lonely. I think it's 3 times, or I will check up on that. But that explains so much of an actual personal experience that I've gone through. And that is going to give people so much clarity that they're not hypersensitive or crazy. It's a physiological thing. I think that is the torture of loneliness too, is if people don't know the science behind it, that it also becomes this kind of ritual of self-blaming and self-loathing. As well. So I think that's
incredible. I'm really sorry you went through that. That's very, very painful.
Thank you. But I actually think the resilience that it gave me, I was in lockdown alone. I live with my partner now, but when the first lockdown happened here in Asia, and because I survived 2014, I was able to be much more resilient in 2020. So I try and look at it like that. But certainly if we had a second wave here, having a partner in the house with me and a little puppy is preferable. So I always talk about the pandemic, the secret pandemic that's lurking under the pandemic we all know about, is a pandemic of loneliness. And you've termed it, and I love this, a social recession. Can you tell us a little bit about that term?
Yeah. I mean, thinking of the economy as a metaphor, you know, we have downturns and upswings and bull markets and bear markets or whatever it is. I'm not an economist or a Wall Street person, but the metaphor becomes pretty apparent right away. We have recessions where people are faced with limited material resources, limited money because of reduced consumer spending and on and on and on. Well, our relationships are similarly, they're an investment. They're an investment in our time and our energy. Other people are a pain in the butt. They want to see a different movie than we want to see. And, you know, and so we have to invest our self-regulation in maintaining a good relationship, right? Mm-hmm. And then that investment brings those returns, which is my expanded self, my ability, my increased efficacy, and all of that stuff. But it is an investment. And what we have now is a situation where, on the one hand, the resource, other people, is limited. And two, our options for investing in other people are limited because we have Zoom instead of, you know, going out to the, you know, the dinner party. Mm-hmm. And what that's doing is putting everyone in danger of running a resource deficit and creating a social recession where broadly across society, you would expect levels of anxiety and depression to go up. And that's, of course, exactly what we're seeing. Yeah. in record numbers, especially in certain age groups in the young.
James, thank you so much. I suppose my last question is, with knowing all that we know over our last half hour conversation, what can people do wherever they're in the world, they're watching this, whether they are in Asia where we're coming out of it seemingly, or whether in countries with second lockdowns, what can we do to feel more connected?
Yeah, we have an answer. What we have to do is enact vulnerability with each other and respond positively to that risk.
Yeah.
And so that's very abstract, right? And people are going to be watching this going, well, what does that even mean? And I'll tell you what it means. I'm going to show you. Yeah. So I was talking about this with my 9-year-old daughter, Lulu. And I was saying, you know, what can my class, my Why We Hold Hands class, do that's kind of scary socially, so that they can be vulnerable with each other? And she goes, sing a song. So what song should we sing? And she gave me this one, and I'm going to sing it for you right now.
Okay.
Goes, it's very short, so don't worry. poor bird, take thy flight high above the sorrow of this sad night. It's a song she learned somewhere. I don't know
beautiful.
Where.
Beautiful.
It's lovely, beautiful. Right?
Yeah.
And I And I asked my students to all sing it to each other. And there was a thunderclap of bonding that started to occur. And if you think about it, this is super easy to see. Go look at videos of Bergamo in Italy when the virus first struck there, and people are going out on their balconies and singing Volare to each other, you know, and the point wasn't to sing well, the point was to sing publicly. Mm-hmm. When you look at Notre Dame burning in Paris, people started gathering in the streets and singing Ave Maria with each other.
It's really interesting you raise this from an Asian perspective. You know, I know most of my clients that I coach in this market are Asian, and we obviously are karaoke lovers. Karaoke came from here. And what I see is being a Chinese woman myself is that we're not raised with showing vulnerability. We're raised to actually mitigate meaning with our expressions and to give face.
Yes.
Particularly in moments of vulnerability. And this means that karaoke is the ultimate release with your peers. We're allowed 8 people here in Singapore. We had a karaoke party recently, and you could not get the mic if you tried. And my partner was like, I have been friends with these guys for 15 years, and I had no idea. I mean, they were taking the mic off each other and singing, because we've all been starved of that bonding, right? it was crazy. It was like throwing a sausage at a group of dogs. It was crazy.
It's so fun. It's so funny that you bring up karaoke, because I have to tell you, this is literally true. For years, I've been obsessed with karaoke, and not doing it necessarily because I'm not, but I want to study it, because it seems like an ingenious enactment of what I just talked about in a structured forum. So you have a society, as you're talking about. I used to live in China myself, and it was difficult for me because I'm like, touch, express, mm-hmm. you know, and so I understand what you're saying, but then you have this context that's structured and ritualized where you go in and you publicly make yourself mm-hmm. incredibly vulnerable. And everybody claps and goes, yay. And you enact, it's almost like a psychological enactment of this deep need. And it serves that purpose.
It does. It's almost like a scheduled time for what we would probably, so I obviously straddle both East and West. As a Western woman, you know, we would book into therapy to have a conversation, but the Asian part of me sees how that might still be stigmatized in certain parts of the region. So I understand how karaoke became the way it became, it like how it took off. And I also am very expressive. I'm an outlier because of my Western education. And I too, when I came here, was actually told by a colleague, you know, don't show so much, don't show everything, because it was construed as weakness, that I was so readable in my body language, in my face, everything. And so because of that, I think this has to be like a fascinating place to study the different parts of it. But I think that's a conversation for another day, Jim. Thank you so much for your time. It has just been mind-blowing. It's going to help so many people. Thank you for being up early in a snowstorm.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me. It's such a pleasure to chat with you.